introducing myself. I'm Dr. Tanvi Thapar. I am from Jaipur. I did my BDS from Savita Dental College in Chennai. And after internship, I shifted back to Jaipur. I joined my parents' practice. So I'm a third generation dentist. My grandfather was a prosthodontist. My grandmother was also a dentist. In fact, she was one of the first female qualified dentists after independence. So then my parents, my mom's an endodontist, my father's a pedodontist, and now me and my brother. My brother is currently pursuing perio in D.Y. Patil, Mumbai. So both of us are third generation dentists. So after I finished my BBS, I joined my dad. I was practicing with him for a year. In fact, assisting him because I had so much to learn and I had such big shoes to fill in. So literally, I was assisting him for a few months before, you know, he started giving me cases. And after a year, I joined my MDS in prosthetics here in Jaipur. I also started my training in CAD-CAM dentistry. We invested in a CAD-CAM and a milling machine. I learned how to use it. I design my bridge, crowns, inlays, veneers, everything on my own. I do all my lab work on my own. And then I got married last year. And then I also started my own clinic in another area in the city, same in Jaipur. So now currently I'm running two clinics and pursuing my passion, which is dentistry. So any questions you guys have regarding anything, please feel free to ask, or you want to text me, or you want any case related questions on my Instagram, you're always free to, you know, just approach me anytime you guys want. Arushi, I think you should take over now because you have all the questions or everybody's asking.
Ma'am, as of now, I would request any questions if anyone has, you can please go ahead and ask. And you can write in the chat box.
Guys, any questions you have regarding, you know, how, like, as a newcomer, when you join a dental clinic, or if you want to start your own practice, or, you know, anything related to practice management also, you can ask me, because trust me, I've experimented with a lot of techniques, even marketing techniques for that matter. And for me, it was very challenging because I come from a family of dentists.
So for me, it was very challenging because I already come from a family of dentists. So I did not have any scope to make mistakes because there's a certain expectations people had. And, I had to create a name for myself separately, which was not associated with my parents. So I've experimented so much. And the main thing which I realized is if you have passion for your subject, if you're very, very passionate about dentistry and... you know, if you have an in-depth knowledge about your subject, then you will succeed, because in the end, it is your treatment which matters. When patients see the success in the treatment, the longevity of the treatment, they will automatically come back to you. So right now, you guys are at a stage where you're learning, you're still learning, you've just started your career. So do as much as practical as possible, treat as many patients as you can, because college is a place where you can make mistakes. You know, you can make mistakes, you can learn from them. Once you start your private practice, you can't afford to make mistakes, because one mistake with one patient means you've lost 10 patients. You know, word of mouth, you lose that patient, you lose that patient's family as your patient, you will lose their friends as your patient. So, you know, you can't make mistakes then. So in college, learn as much as you can. when I was doing my BBS, so whichever department case I used to get, I used to make sure that, you know, I know everything, all procedures which are done in that particular department. I had an advantage because I've been, you know, hearing these things and looking at these things since childhood. But say for perio is not just scaling. Perio is your curettage, perio is route planning, perio is I'll say gingival formation in your implant, you know, anteriorly when you place implants, we're doing a smile grinding. Perio plays a very important role in that. So gingival contouring, depigmentation. So when you take one particular subject, you should know all the possible procedures in that particular field and try to do all these procedures when you're doing your BBS. Because when you complete your BBS, you should be confident enough to start your own practice. That's how it should be. So do as many cases as you can when you're doing a BBS. It's okay, you will make mistakes. When you're doing a tooth preparation, you might expose the pulp by mistake. It's okay, do a root canal. It's fine, but do as many cases as you can.
Ma'am, we have some questions coming in. So Sanika is asking, for a fresher, what are the basic things to learn in private practice compared to college? I think all of us want to know is, ma'am, apart from the dentistry learning, what other fields should we know about to start a private practice apart from the dentistry thing?
When you talk about starting your own practice along with the dentistry, you need to know how to, you know, run your practice, which means you, for example, I'll just give an example. If today my suction stops working or the dental chair stops working, then, you know, suddenly I have to call the mechanic or, you know, deal with the company whose chair I have. So one thing is you have to thoroughly know about your dental armamentarium, which is starting from your chair to your suction to how to maintain it, clean it, your instruments, everything. You have to know everything about the armamentarium, because now, right now you're in college, there is somebody else who's in charge for these things. But when you start your practice, it is your practice, it is your equipment, it's your armamentarium. So you have to know everything about their maintenance. This is one. Second is, you need to find out means of marketing. So you need to be very good with your marketing. See, some people feel that, oh, you know, like, I'm a doctor, why should I get into marketing, or why should I get into social media? I believe that right now we're in an age where marketing is everything. You know, you need to sell your skill. If I go buy clothes or if I go buy shoes, you know, I am attracted to the skill. I'm attracted to the design. I'm attracted to the colors. Now, you as a dentist, what is your skill? Your skill is your work. So earlier, I used to be very reluctant in, like, you know, showing my cases on Instagram or Facebook or, you know, on the website, that, you know, why would I, show some people's teeth? But then I realized that that's my talent. This is what I have to showcase about. And that's how I started posting about it. So the second thing is your marketing. Marketing can be of different, marketing can be done in different ways. When you're a newcomer, you need to do your digital as well as physical marketing also. When I started my practice last year, so although we have a very big name in the city, but still, you know, for people to recognize the clinic in a new area, I distributed a lot of pamphlets. I kept a lot of dental camps. I gave, you know, advertisements in the newspaper. Then obviously Instagram, Facebook, and your Google marketing was already there. So you need to be very good with your marketing. The third thing is your administration. See, when you will start your practice, you will need a receptionist, you will need an assistant, you will need somebody who's cleaning your clinic. Because all these things, I call them atomic habits. You know, there are these very small things which will make a lot of difference in your practice. Say, today you are visiting a dentist or you are visiting any doctor and you see the clinic is not very clean. You will not get a very good vibe from that clinic, right? So you need to make sure that your clinic is being cleaned every day. Your receptionist is very well dressed, very well spoken. Now, this is what you need to teach them. Then you will have to know everything about your accounting, how you're keeping your case files, how you want to, you know, kind of set rules for your clinic. So along with your dentistry, if you're planning to start your own practice, these are the things you would need. Now, nowadays I see a lot of dentists who are switching into cosmetology also. That, I mean, I don't know. I am not a very big fan of this thing, because I believe when you've done dentistry, then you're a dentist. You know, there are so many procedures in dentistry which you can focus on, which you can specialize in. And I don't see any point in diversifying your field. But if it's working for somebody, it's well and good. Like, you know, they can go for it. Like, some dentists believe that since, like, I have a laser, I use laser for my smile designing procedures, you know, to do gingival contouring, for laser bleaching, for even for pedo root canals, I use laser. Now, some people say, when you have laser, why not use it for skin treatments also? I mean, yeah, sure, why not? But I don't believe in that. I believe if I'm a dentist, I want to stick to my profession. But definitely, you have a choice of going into cosmetology as well. And yeah, I think these are the things which you would... Oh, and one more thing is that right now, I know because of COVID, there are not many conferences which are happening, but I feel you should attend as many lectures as possible, attend as many CD programs and, you know, foreign speaker lectures, because you are never too old to learn and you will never know everything. There are so many new things which are happening in dentistry every single day, and you need to keep upgrading yourself. You cannot just stick to amalgam restoration. You know, nobody does amalgam anymore world over. Now you do lithium disilicate, you do feldspathic fillings. So every day that thing is improving, and you need to be updated with that. You being updated with the latest technology means that you're progressing in your field. So you're never too old to learn, and just keep attending as many courses as possible. Even if you pick up one good thing from the course or from the lecture, that's a game for you. So yeah, I think that's about it.
Yes ma'am, thank you ma'am. Ma'am, Soumya is asking, hello ma'am, will you suggest a good fellowship while doing internship from some good colleges?
No, I would not suggest you do any fellowship while doing internship, because internship is that 1 year where you can do maximum number of procedures. Your entire focus should be on your procedures, because see, I agree, when you're in your third year, in your final year, you have that exam stress, you have, you know, a particular quota to finish. That thing is not there in your internship. So internship is one time where you can do so much, you can do so much of practical work. So I would not suggest to do fellowship along with internship. Yes, definitely, once you finish your internship and you do not want to pursue MDS, then you can definitely go for fellowship. I know Savita has really good fellowships, Savita Chennai, where I did my BDS from. They have fellowships in ortho, they have fellowship in aesthetics, they have fellowship in implantology, and they are really good. Like, I know a couple of people who are doing fellowships from there, and I've seen good results, good knowledge. So yeah, I think that's, you can check that out, and I'm sure DY Patil, I mean, all premier institutes will be having fellowship courses. But during internship, don't do it. Once you finish your internship, definitely you can go for it.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello, yeah.
Ma'am, like, I have heard about medical cosmetology fellowships. Ma'am,
yeah.
What all do they include?
I am not a very big fan of doing cosmetology, because I'm a dentist, I'm not a cosmetologist. But yes, I know a lot of people, a lot of dentists who are pursuing cosmetology. There are good courses in Bombay. There are good courses in Delhi also. There's one, Jamunabai Institute, which is a very premier institute for cosmetology in Bombay. You can check those out. But I personally do not want to go towards cosmetology, because, I mean, I just have so many dental patients, I don't want to switch to cosmetology. But you can definitely check out these courses. There are short courses also, like 2-3 days courses. There are, I think, 15 days courses also. But do it from a good institute. And by good institute, I mean somewhere in Bombay or Delhi, or I think there might be in Bangalore, not sure. But Bombay ones I've heard of.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
ma'am, Sravani is asking, hi Dr. Tanvi, which kind of treatments or procedures do you suggest a freshly passed out BDS student to focus on before starting their own practice in the current times, like aesthetic procedures or RCTs, etc.?
See, I'll tell you the basic bread and butter in your dentistry is, you know, there are these few firsts. You're scaling, a very good scaling, because you know, you get so many patients who want to get a good scaling and polishing done. So I'll say your scaling, polishing, your composite fillings. Have your basics about composites very clear. Have your basics about bonding and etching very clear. So your scaling, your composite fillings, your extractions, because you know, one, a very hopeless tooth with a bad paining tooth with a bad prognosis, you need to remove it. So your extraction, and I would say your impression making, because you know, dentures can be made in the lab, but then your impressions have to be really good. And I've seen so I keep a lot of BDS students, like for observership or even like new hires, and I realize one thing, the impression making, I don't know, somehow is not very good. So have your basics about impression making very, very clear. And glass rhinoma, definitely. You know, mixing of glass rhinoma, how do you use it, what is the setting. So these are the very basic, and your root canals. Every second patient comes to your clinic has a root canal. So these are the few procedures which you need to be very, very thorough with before you start your practice. That is your scaling, your fillings, extractions, impression making, and root canals. These five procedures definitely you should know. Implant and aesthetics is something which is a little advanced. I think once you start your practice, you will not, you know, suddenly get aesthetic patients for veneers. Because in India right now, the demand for aesthetics is not very high. Veneer patients, you need to create those patients. You know, nobody will directly come to you and tell you that, okay, change all my upper eight teeth, or I don't like my smile, change all my teeth. Because the awareness about veneers is not there. You need to point it out to the patient that, oh, you know what, if you get these teeth corrected like that, your smile would become better. Now, to do those veneers, your basics about composites and ceramics has to be clear. So veneers and implants, I'll say something, you know, a little more advanced. But when you're starting your practice, have these basic procedure very, very clear and be very confident about them. And then you can definitely switch to like advanced things. I hope that answered the question.
Ma'am, Gayatri is asking, hello ma'am, do YouTube and other dental websites help in learning the dental procedures nicely, or we learn the most when we assist a case?
No. So what I used to do is, before assisting or before, you know, I used to do any procedure, I used to look up the case on YouTube, or, you know, at least the procedures, and or even on the, you know, the company websites. Because when you're using one particular material, suppose, for example, say I'm bonding a veneer. Now, I know that bonding is basically composite, right? Your adhesive is composite. So, you know, the steps that, okay, this is the etchant. Suppose hydrochloric acid, this much you need to etch it for this many seconds, then bond it like that, air dry it like that, cure it like that. So definitely the procedure, the theoretical procedure, you will know when you look at the video. When you assist the case, definitely you learn more, because see, every human mouth is different. You know, every case is different. So the practical knowledge you will know only when you're assisting. But then the basics and the understanding of the material. For example, when I put the bond, so in the book it will be, okay, you put the bond, cure it, and then you put composite on that. But when you assist, you will know when you're putting the bond, then you need to air thin it. You know, why you need to air thin it? So that in the corners, that bond does not get accumulated. When it evaporates, it will leave a void. Right? So now this air thinning, you know only when you assist it. Because then you can actually practically see that bond flowing. So both the things are very important, but yes, definitely before assisting, you have to know what you're assisting and what exactly are the steps. So So definitely you should check out YouTube, you should check out the company websites, the company videos, and then yes, assisting has its own advantages as well. I'm not able to see the question that you are missing. Are there any other questions?
I'm in the chat box. These were the only questions. I'm waiting if someone is typing, or if they have a thought in mind and they're just...
Guys, please feel free to ask any questions, even if you have some case if you need guidance about. Just feel free to ask me. I was supposed to share cases with you today, but because there's such heavy rains in Jaipur right now, I couldn't access my laptop. So we will be sharing cases probably in another session.
Ma'am, there is one question.
Yeah.
Bhavika is asking, ma'am, is MDS really important? Even if you feel that you have a good hold over basic skills that you just told us about.
See, I was in this dilemma for a very long time because when I finished my BTS, I was also like very confident that, you know, I know everything and I am ready to start my own practice. But honestly, MDS really opened my mind because the type of procedures and the in-depth knowledge I had to study during my MDS, during my thesis, the library dissertation, the journal clubs. It's a very different world, you know, because you are so focused on one particular subject. It really opens up your mind, and it was, my BDS was a very life-changing experience for me, especially in a college like Savita. And MDS was a step even above that, I'll say, because you know, BDS you study the basics, and I'll say MDS you study the base, starting from the basics till the future of dentistry. But definitely in that one particular subject, like I did prosthetics, so I studied only prosthetics. But definitely the way MDS opened my brains was very different. So don't think that MDS is not important. MDS is very important, but I'll say it is more of the knowledge of the advancement, the knowledge of what the future of dentistry can be, which also you can achieve by attending multiple courses, by doing small fellowships, because that helps a lot. When I was doing my MDS, I made sure that I attend all conferences possible. So I used to go to every conference, I used to attend every webinar, everything, any small course I used to attend. So I will not say MD is important or not, but definitely opening up your minds to newer things in dentistry is very
important. Ma'am, Janvi is saying, ma'am, I'm not willing to do MDS, so I'm planning to settle abroad. So I have been looking over for other courses like Master in Public Health, Diploma courses or Certificate courses. There are other courses like dental hygiene and dental assistance courses, but I'm really not sure if I should take up a dental auxiliary course or should I go for DDS standing.
Moving abroad after doing your BDS is it's quite complicated, but then this is where you need to realize where your passion lies. If you're very passionate as a clinician, you know, if you want to practice dentistry to its fullest, then you should do the DDS and then, you know, that process. I know it will be, you know, it's like repeating your BDS again for 2 years, but then in the end, it's worth it. If you're looking for, you know, a quick settling in abroad, that, you know, something which just ensures that, okay, you are working and you're settled abroad, then definitely you can go in for the hygienist course or the dental assistant course. But honestly speaking, if you're a hardcore clinician, I am a hardcore clinician. I want to operate. I want to do very, you know, good dentistry. I want to keep improving my skills as a dentist. So I would not go for a dental hygienist course because I feel that is going to limit your working, because there are these certain procedures abroad where what a hygienist cannot do. So that is going to limit your working. Whereas if you do that EDS for 2 years and then you join, you are a full, you know, a fully practitioner. A full clinician. So now that is where your interest lies. If you want to be a clinician, or you want to, you know, if you're okay with not, because there are some people who are more interested in the, I'll say, the administrative work, or, you know, they want to keep the working very light and organized, then definitely you can go for that. But if you are okay with the working hours and everything, then go in for the DPS. And also for girls, I'll say, your marriage plays a very big role, because for me it was a very big change, you know, adjusting, because my working hours was, like, before marriage I used to even work till like 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night, which I had to, you know, kind of change after I got married. So I understand that this is, for girls, it's a very difficult thing to manage. So I will say, look at all these aspects and then take your decision.
Ma'am, Navika is asking, ma'am, which place one should learn implants and veneers from in case not doing MBS?
See, implants, I feel implants, theory you can learn from anywhere. There are a lot of courses for implants, but unless and until you don't place implants yourself, or you don't, you know, assist in implant surgeries, you will not understand, because implant, trust me, no matter how much you read about it, when you actually enter that bone, everything changes. So, implant, there are a lot of fellowships. There is one fellowship in Savita, one of my juniors, she was working in my clinic. I've sent her to Savita to do that implant fellowship. You implant, definitely go in for a fellowship to a place where you're able to place implants yourself, because for implants, especially, theory is not enough. For veneers, there is no, you know, special fellowship as such, but there are courses. I also conduct a lot of courses on veneers, so if you guys are interested in it, you can always DM me. I teach composite and ceramic veneers as well, because smile makeovers is my specialization. But implants, I would say, definitely go to a place where you can place it on your own, because theory in implant is not enough. For implants, you can also attend these CD programs which the companies organize. Like, I know, for example, Austin organizes a lot of implant courses, but they will make you place implants in dummy, but start with that. And then probably you can attend courses where you can place, you know, fellowship where you can place implants in the patients yourself. So you can check out the company courses also. I don't know after this COVID situation if they are conducting courses or not, but till last year they were. So you need to check that out. For veneers, you can definitely contact me. I would be very happy to send you all the details of the courses.
Amma Namika is asking about future options after doing DDS.
In DDS, you can join any private practice abroad, or if you want to work in the government hospital, you can do that also. Dentists are very highly paid in the US. I know it is very difficult to get in, and clearing DDS is very difficult, but once you do it and, you know, you get a good placement there, it's really nice. I would not suggest that you start your practice immediately, your own private practice. But, you know, rather assist somebody there, you know, join some practice or join a hospital there. Because one very, very big part in the US is understanding the medical legal. So I did a fellowship in Australia for about, you know, me and my brother, both of us there for about a month. And trust me, with every procedure, they used to teach us the medical legal part of it as well. In India, the stress on medical legal is not so much, but in America, it's a lot. So I think when you move countries after DDS, it's always better to, you know, understand the working of that particular country and then think of starting your own practice. So after DDS, I'll suggest join a clinic there, or join a hospital there, or join a government job there. Do it for a few years, understand everything, and then if you feel confident enough and settled, then start your own practice.
And we'll just wait for a few more minutes. If anyone has any question, they can absolutely write it down.
If you have questions later, you can always either text Arushi or you can directly text me on Instagram, and I would be really happy to answer any questions or any doubts you have. And I will definitely take a session for all the cases. I'm really sorry I couldn't present today because of the rain, but definitely I'll plan a session with Arushi soon and you guys can check that out.
Yes, ma'am, definitely. And these weather conditions, these keep happening, ma'am. Little problems, no worries.
I know.
And we really appreciate, ma'am, you took out time for us, you took out the whole day for us, you made sure to show us. And if for us undergraduate students, everything is new for us because we haven't experienced, we're in college right now. So everything we have is to learn. So thank you so much for taking out the time, ma'am. Have a good evening. Take care.
Take care, all of you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye. Good night. Thank you, ma'am.